having to do with state expenditures and taxes and revenues. Okay. Do you support any state expenditure reductions? If so, which ones, and how much would you reduce spending? If not, why not?
Thank you. As a member of the legislature, I have supported a number of spending reductions in the legislature. In fact, in 2009, when the state faced a significant revenue shortfall, over half of that shortfall was made up by cuts to programs and services, to all of the services that we value in the state of Oregon. Both as a school board member and a legislator, I've been willing to make tough votes when things don't work anymore. For instance, I know that some of you received some mail the other day talking about how I had voted to close the Oregon School for the Blind. When we closed the Oregon School for the Blind, it only had 32 kids, and only 9 of them were blind. They had lost their accreditation decades ago and hadn't awarded a high school diploma in 20 years, yet we were spending over $150,000 per student. That was not a good use of public resources. We redirected that money to be able to better serve the 850 blind and visually impaired students all across the state. As a member of the Revenue Committee, we work to reprioritize our tax expenditures. It makes sense to use our tax code to incent new behaviors in people. But there comes a time when we don't need to pay people to do things anymore. Really great example of this. We absolutely must act to address climate change, and we need to reduce our carbon emissions. So the state created a tax credit for people to purchase fuel-efficient vehicles. That was great, and it worked. But once there was a 2-year wait or a long wait to be able to purchase a Prius, we didn't need to pay people to do that anymore. That was no longer a good use of our public funds. So we have worked to put, and I have worked as a member of the Revenue Committee, to put all of our tax expenditures on a timeline so that each of them sunsets, and we have to look at whether or not that public money is being spent to accomplish the policy purpose that's needed. We turn back a lot of money through our tax expenditures and loopholes, and that is a place where we can do a lot of work, and I'm committed to continuing to do that work.
Thank you. Well, budgeting is a very difficult process, and if you've ever been to Salem and stepped in on the Ways and Means Committee, you see that, because everybody wants their program funded. What we've done over the years when I was in the House is that we used a current service level budget and we increased it 2% every year, or 3%, or whatever the percentage was. So it was always rolling up, and we knew that we always had to cover the roll-ups. Well, you can do that when times are good and there's not an economic downturn, but we are no longer in that situation where our revenues are decreasing. So what I have advocated for is a zero-based budgeting. You start at zero, and every agency has to come in, and they have to provide their plan, basically what they need to give the services that they think are essential and should be given. You can always add on to that, but you start at zero. Also, we should look at all the programs we have, because things tend to get funded over the decades, because they were always funded. So we need to not fund any program that we wouldn't fund today. Another thing we can do is look at middle management. We have a lot of salaries in Oregon, $200,000 salaries, and we should look at salaries and make sure that what's being paid for equal work in the private sector should match what's being paid in government. So those are some ideas I have. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Close. The next question kind of piggybacks on that. And the essence of this question, it was stated to me a couple of days ago, that Oregon State University is a large footprint on the overall landmass of Corvallis, but it does not contribute any property taxes. And would either or both of you do any advocating up in Salem to try to find funding to provide to OSU that they could in turn provide to Corvallis for services that are not compensated? Whose turn is it?
Well, this is a local problem that's difficult for the legislature to look at. We try not to get involved in your local issues because you have elected people that represent you, but I would certainly be willing to help out in that effort. You know, it really helps us a lot in Salem is to convene a work group. Anytime committee chairs, and I've been to chair 3 committees, when you don't have agreement, you say, okay, all you guys go out of the room and decide when you're going to meet and form a work group and come we get really good legislation when we go to work groups. So that's what I would suggest between the city and OSU. I think what we have to do is make sure that because OSU is using a lot of services, water, sewer, electricity, that there should be some sort of fee that they pay the city to make sure that the infrastructure is being supported as well, because as you all know, that all has to be fixed and maintained. And so that would be the thing I would bring up in a work group. Another thing you could look at would be more user fees on things that the students are using. If they're using the parks for meetings, then you need to look at if you're charging enough to maintain the parks for those kinds of services. But this would be very delicate, and it would need to be done carefully. Thank you.
I think we all know that we have a lot of work to do in the community as Oregon State University grows to improve the relationship between the university and the city. That is work that we read about almost every day in the Gazette Times, and that I know our city councilors are deeply engaged in. One of the things that I've done, there was a conversation about whether or not it makes sense to pay the state police to provide the security services on campus, and whether or not those services would be better provided by city police, and if that could be a generator of revenue for the city. I convened some folks together to look at that, and have always been responsive to people that have asked those questions. OSU's growth is causing challenges for the city. That's absolutely certain, certainly driving up the cost of rent. But we also have to recognize that, first of all, the university does pay for its water, sewage, and electricity. They don't get it for free. But they also are a huge economic driver for this community. They're one of our largest employers. We bring in millions and millions of research dollars, and one of the things that I think that we could do better is increase our investment in the efficiency of our technology transfer process. We can do a better job of quickly turning around Oregon ideas and turning them in to Oregon jobs. We have to make that easier. So when things are built up, when they're manufactured, and when they're sold, it's Oregon people that are put to work putting together the things that Oregonians have dreamed of and researched at our universities. And that is going to be a great benefit to Corvallis, to Eugene, to every place that houses a university. Thank you.
Thank you, Representative Gelser. There are three questions that are very close that have just been submitted here today. I'll try to wrap it up into about one long sentence. Considering the massive cost to taxpayers resulting from cover already, what would be a solution that you would bring to the legislature going forward, and would you recommend just shelving the whole system and coming up with a new idea?
Can you say that one more time?
Okay.
Sorry.
Considering the massive cost to taxpayers resulting from cover already, and the fact that it essentially, although some people have been brought on health care, but the cost factor with already, how would you advocate, in other words, recovering some of that money, and what do we do going forward? Scrap the system entirely or improve on it?
Thank you. First, we scrap Cover Oregon. Cover Oregon has been a failure and an embarrassment as an agency, and it needs to be disbanded. I'm disappointed they didn't vote to disband themselves. I look forward to the opportunity to disband them. In February, I voted for legislation that would create greater sideboards on future contracts that might be similar to Cover Oregon. But that really was a failure of administrative oversight. What we need to do is hold Oracle accountable for the part that they were responsible for in delivering to the state of Oregon a software program that did not work. But as we shut down the Cover Oregon agency, we need to make sure that we're taking care of the Oregonians that have been enrolled in healthcare coverage. What we promised when we voted for the healthcare exchange was that Oregonians would be able to better access quality, affordable healthcare coverage for themselves and their families. That part of the goal, we accomplished. The plans that were inside the Oregon Exchange were some of the best in the country when you looked at their low premiums, their low deductibles, and the comprehensive quality of coverage that Oregonians were able to access. I heard from many people, some of you in this room, who had a very difficult time because the Cover Oregon enrollment process didn't work. But once people were enrolled, they really liked the coverage. Today, Oregon's insurance rate is 95%. Only 5% of Oregonians don't have access to health care today. And over 150,000 Oregonians that didn't have access to health today, by any measure, that is a success. And we need to preserve that success and stand up for those Oregonians to make sure that they don't lose ground in that area. The next step is making sure that they have access to providers that can provide that care. Insurance coverage is only the first step. Access to medical, dental, vision, and mental health care in every community in the state, when you need it and where you need it, is the next step that we need to work on next session.
Well, Cover Oregon is a poster child for failed leadership. I believe that healthcare decisions should be made by patients, their doctors, and not Washington, D.C., or Salem. So we're left with a system, Cover Oregon, which I would not have voted for because I figured, you know, the federal government passed this legislation, let them take the cost of setting up the website, and not every single state. And many states did that. I believe about half the states said no. Federal government set up your own system, and we'll be part of that system. So that's what I would have voted for. Now we see $300 million wasted. There's $20 million left. Cover Oregon is still spending that money every day, and they're going to spend it until the open enrollment in November 15th when the federal government has their open enrollment. And we can't find out what that money's being spent on every day. It's about $200,000 a day. So it's still a disaster. Another layer of government. I think we should be trying to lower health costs, not raise them. These policies that people are getting depend on the young people, and there's many of you in the back, buying into the system, and they're not doing that because the costs are so high. One guy told me $1,600 a month would be his policy. Then the deductible is so high that they will not actually get coverage until they get to a very high amount of money. So we really need to go back and start over and get a system that works. And we had a good system, I think, but we needed to fix several things. The insurance across state lines. We need to look at tort reform because that's driving our health care costs higher. So I'll be working on that. Thank you.
We're going to shift gears a little bit and talk about marijuana legislation. Marijuana legislation is on the ballot this November. With all the problems we are seeing in Washington and Colorado, what is your position on the marijuana legislation ballot that's there, and why?
Well, I hope voters will look at this very carefully. I don't take positions on ballot measures because I figure it's been sent to the people and it's your decision, and I don't want to influence people unduly on those kinds of votes. However, I'm the vice chair of the Senate Judiciary Committee, and in joint judiciary over there, we had people come and testify before our committee on what's happening in Washington, what's happening in Colorado. And it was pretty stunning. An attorney came out of Florida, a volunteer. He works for a group, run by one of the Kennedy brothers, and they go around the country for free. But he had a slideshow that showed a lot of things people don't know, especially the food. The food is labeled to look like Pop-Tarts, only it's called Pop-Tarts. And so you couldn't tell. I couldn't tell looking. The packaging was the same. The colors were the same. The drinks looked just like the regular drinks, like Red Bull, but they were marijuana-laced products. So we know there's been deaths in Cafe in Colorado because of that, and they've done autopsies and found that the only thing that hurt the person that jumped off the building in his bloodstream was THC. So I would suggest we step back, watch those states, and see what the problems are before we vote to legalize that here, because I think it will be dangerous to children. Even dogs and cats are dying because they're eating that food. So let's count the cost carefully. Thank you.
I think the important question here is what happens after November. I think all of the polls indicate that Oregonians are, in the majority, going to vote in favor of that measure. When the legislature comes into session in February, we need to figure out how to regulate that. That has to do with how can things be marketed? How do we make sure that you don't have access to marijuana? What do we do about the safety of driving on the road? How do we measure whether or not a person is under the influence of marijuana? These are things that are incredibly important that we need to look at when we come back.
Thank you, Representative Gelser. I'm going to shift gears back to a question that was submitted now. Everyone speaks about growing wealth. What is your definition of growing wealth? And how do we accomplish this and make this a reality? And with that, about jobs, I'm going to combine two questions here. Jobs, this person said, we hear a lot about job creation. One out of every three jobs in the country is currently a minimum wage job. How do you propose to create jobs that pay substantially more than minimum wage? Young people like myself, referring to this person, obviously not me, cannot think of buying a home and starting a family on $10 to $12 per hour. So we're talking about creating wealth and jobs, creating good jobs. And this is the Representative Gelser.
Thank you. That's a lot for 2 minutes. Those are the questions of the ages. In terms of growing wealth and individuals building their own wealth, I think traditionally in our American culture, that really has been the ability to buy a home, to make that concrete, that literally concrete wood investment in the place that you live and that you grow your family in. That becomes more and more difficult for people as housing costs rise and wages fall. As the questioner mentioned, we have a lot of people that are working for very low wages today. Part of that is the consequence of the choices that we all make. We want lots of things. We want them to be bigger and we want them to be cheaper. And the way that we get them bigger and cheaper is we buy them from other countries that have lower wages. So supporting products that are grown and made right here in the United States is one of the things that we can each do individually to help improve wages. There's a lot of misunderstanding about who minimum wage workers are. The vast majority of them are women. The majority are contributing more than half of their family's income and are working more than full time. They are trying to use that money to pay for rent, for food, for medicine, for health care, for school fees, for the student loan debt that we talked about earlier. There isn't enough on $9.15 an hour to be able to, $9.10 an hour, to be able to do all of those things and save to buy a house and to build wealth. So what we really need to do is retool our economy to make sure that everybody has a fair shot at prosperity. Everybody has a fair shot at building a retirement account that works for them, building the savings that will allow them to purchase a home. That involves pay equity, it involves increasing the minimum wage, and it involves better training programs that bring back the trades. We have stigmatized those jobs, and those are great paying jobs that kids can have right out of high school or a two-year institution if we are able to put shop classes back in our middle and high schools, which is something I've been working on since I was on the Corvallis School Board, long before it was popular to talk about it.
Well, thank you. How do you grow wealth? Well, what is wealth? It's any object, things, services, art, intangibles like education, experience, that people value. Family is wealth in many cultures because that allows them opportunities if they have a lot of people helping them in their family. You have to produce something to have wealth, and to do that, you need a work ethic. Maybe you get a job somewhere and you decide you're going to work overtime so you can save up because you want to buy some land, you want to be a farmer. So you need that work ethic. Private property you need. If you own your own land, we've seen this in other nations where people don't, you're motivated to succeed because you want to profit from the works of your hands. Just to give you an example, in the 1970s in India, adult males could only own 18 irrigated acres. So what happened was they couldn't do mass production because you can't do it on 18 acres. You couldn't buy a $40,000 tractor because it couldn't be used. So you didn't have economies of scale. Also didn't have a free market in India because they controlled grain prices and created shortages. So people need something to strive for. And I'll just give you an example. One business in the Mid Valley that makes this is the Fresno Bee. They make pressure chambers. In this little suitcase, maybe you can see 25% of the farmers in California are using, and they take a leaf and they put it in the pressure chamber and they tell them how much water is in that leaf. And so in a drought situation, this really helps them. This is our little Albany company. Somebody invented this. They got a patent. And this is how you build wealth through hard work and capital. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm going to go back to another question that was submitted. And this has to do, again, with the economy. With the economy and exports, how do you each propose to help increase exports of Oregon products, especially Oregon wine throughout the world? And this obviously came from an owner of a vineyard. And Senator Close.
All right, well, exports and imports. What those are is what is shipped to and from a country. You export if you produce goods at a lower cost than other countries. We've seen China do that. Or your goods are in demand for outstanding quality. You see Germany do that with their automobiles. Everybody wants the German cars. Not as good. Sometimes it's seasonal. You export things to countries because they don't have the climate that produces those things. We buy coffee from Africa and South America because they have the climate for coffee. In this country, although I've seen it in Hawaii being grown. Also, if you can't produce something in volume, like French perfumes, then you import that. So we have to take advantage of the climate we have, and it's very good here, our technology. Here we have mildew-resistant wheat that OSU has come up with, so we've used our technology to take care of our mildew problems. We have to have natural resources that are good. Our Douglas fir is highly prized around the world for building materials because of its grain and its strength. And other countries don't have the climate to produce the Douglas fir like we do. So it's really interesting. Government can help by not raising barriers to people's businesses. Higher taxes hurt businesses and they can't hire as many people, can't buy as much equipment. Higher costs, like higher fuel prices, will hurt our businesses because they can't ship as easily. And in California, we have the problem of truckers going out of business because they can't afford the high fuel costs on them. So government has to be careful what we pass and we don't hamper our imports and our exports and our production. Thank you.
So first of all, to whoever in the room owns a vineyard, thank you for Oregon wine, which is one of the most wonderful things about Oregon, and we enjoy that in our house and enjoy looking for it when we travel to other parts of the country. Specifically to increasing exports of Oregon wines, I was really pleased last session to be able to advocate pretty aggressively for investment in Oregon State University's fermentation science program. What we are able to do for the wine industry through investment in research is to develop the traits that we know, kind of the flavor traits in wines that are attractive to other parts of the world. Through that research, our vineyards are going to be able to better develop wines that are attractive, that people want to buy in other kinds of places. We can also study different types of yeasts, how to use yeast to make products more stable so that they can survive that long shipping time. Another Oregon product that is incredibly important around the world in terms of exports is our specialty seed industry. Right here in the Willamette Valley, we have a world-famous specialty seed industry. Lots of jobs, lots of revenue coming into this area. I went on a fellowship a couple of years ago, and people were pleased when they learned where I lived, and they said, wow, our vegetables come from where you live. That's where we get our vegetable seeds. Last session, one of my priority bills was to protect that industry by making sure that canola was not introduced into the protected zone in the Willamette Valley. We had an investor from Japan that flew out just for the hearing to say that they would no longer be able to purchase Oregon seeds if canola was allowed to be introduced into the Willamette Valley. That would have devastated the exports of our specialty seeds, not just in Oregon, but in this region specifically. I was proud to champion that bill. That's certainly a difference between my opponent and I as she opposed the bill. But these are the things that we need to do to protect Oregon businesses and make sure that we can export Oregon products to other parts of the country and other parts of the world.
Thank you. The next question was submitted today here. This is referring to our legal system. What's your view on the increasing number of liability lawsuits bogging down our legal system and their direct correlation to astronomical increases in insurance premiums. How would you address this?
Representative Gelser, I believe you're first on this one. Yeah.
So I'm processing the question in my mind. I do think it's important for consumers to be able to hold bad actors accountable when they have acted negligently and have harmed people. I also think that it is important that our court system works effectively and efficiently to be able to weed out frivolous types of claims. Certainly in the legislature, I served on the tort reform task force. We looked at how to address some of these issues related to medical costs. There's certainly a balance there that needs to be reached. We do need to make sure that patients, when they are harmed due to negligence or bad actors, are able to recover the costs that they need. We also need to make sure that practitioners are able to do their jobs. These are issues that it's hard for me to support anything that would tell an individual that they can't pursue a claim. Unfortunately, you can't legislate common sense. And I think there are a lot of things where we could use a lot more common sense in our communities.
Well, lawsuits are a problem in that they are expensive, and it's expensive for our courts. And one of the things we struggle with every session is how to fund our courts and their increasing costs. I like small claims court because it has a $10,000 limit that you can get damages in. You don't need an attorney, you can testify for yourself. And they will often refer things to arbitrators if it's a difficult case. And then you go into a room and you agree to his decision and you present your information. So that helps to keep costs down. We want to be sure, though, we're funding those types of courts and taking care of those budgets, because the counties increasingly don't have the money. Some counties close on Friday, they're not open on Friday to save costs. The other thing that's talked about a lot is the concept of loser pays. If there's a cost to going in and you're pretty sure you may lose, that might be a frivolous lawsuit. And so if there's some sort of law that says the loser pays, then people will think twice about suing. What we hope is that people can sit down together and work things out and not have to go through the full-blown cost of a court case. And so we try to make that possible. I was involved as the chair of the business committee where we passed a bill that says on housing projects where there was a mold problem that homeowners could sue, but they had to go through the builder and give him a chance to fix that problem, to repair it, before they went for the lawsuit. And that helped a great deal. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Close. Well, this next question is actually three questions, all related, and I'm going to roll into one. And it has to do with climate change. And the first part of it is, would you please tell us about your approach to the problem of climate change? And second to that, at another event yesterday, a gentleman said to me, how will the Willamette Valley and Central Oregon cope with all of the climate refugees that will be coming here in the next decade? And the third part of that, if we get more people here and climate is changing, how will our current water, which is sufficient, it'll be an issue going forward. So again, we're talking about climate change, influx of climate refugees coming to the area, and water. And Senator Close.
Thank you. Well, I'm not surprised about climate refugees because I'm probably one of those. I was brought up in Washington State, where in an area where we got 90 inches of rain a year, so this is a great place to be, and it really does rain less in Oregon, believe it or not, for us Washingtonians. The climate has always changed over the centuries. You can see that if you look at the climate maps at 100-year increments around the Revolutionary War. You know, you've seen the pictures of Washington crossing the Delaware, and there's ice floes out there. Well, that was a time of extreme cold. We know that's happened over the years. So what do we do about that? Well, I want to read a statement from the Wall Street Journal. Dr. Stephen Conan, he was Undersecretary for Science at the Energy Department during Obama's first term. He agrees the climate is changing and humans are impacting it. but only 1% to 2%. He stated that most climate change models not only miss the temperature flattening in the past 16 years, they do not capture a huge factor like oceans or water vapor, cloud formations, rainfall, solar flares. So we just don't know how the climate will change over the next century. But I do know, and I'll refer you back to the article I brought about the pressure chambers. This is technology addressing a problem of climate change and rainfall and drought. So I have faith that as these problems arise, we will come up with the technology to make sure that it's not a disaster, because that's what we do here at Oregon State University. We're very good at it. Thank you.
Well, I do believe that climate change is real, and I do believe that it is impacted by humans, and I believe that it is probably the most pressing public policy issue that faces us today. It's one that will affect many, many generations to come. I think in the original question, I don't think we have enough water in Oregon today. If you look at the state as a whole, you look at Southern Oregon and the intense fighting that you've had in Southern Oregon about water rights that's even turned to violence at times. You've had to have law enforcement intervention. Some of the most heated debates that we have in the state legislature about how to balance water rights and the need for water for fish, the need for water for irrigation, the need for water for the sport fishing industry and recreational use. We battle a lot and debate a lot about the best use of our water. The question about climate refugees and an increasing population is one that we have to look at for a variety of reasons. That's why we need strong land use planning, we need strong water planning, we need to look at how do we adjust to an increasing population. That has to do with infrastructure, it has to do with schools, it has to do with good urban planning. But back to the issue of climate change, there is a lot that we can do to start with. We can improve the energy efficiency in our homes. We can look at driving more fuel-efficient vehicles. We can, back to that planning, do better planning so that people rely on cars less. That has to do with new housing developments, making sure that places are walkable and bikeable so that people can get to work, can get to school, can get to the market without needing to drive a car. This is a difficult challenge. It's one that we all need to address, and it's frankly one of the reasons why I am running for the state senate. Time and again, the Oregon House has passed good legislation that would help us address the issue of climate change, but it's gone to the Senate, and it has died by just one vote. We can't control solar flares, but we can control the things that are actually impacting climate change, and that's what I'm committed to doing, and that's the reality that we all need to face.
Thank you, Representative Gelser. It's now about 4 minutes to one, and I think I'll pause for a second for anyone that may have to leave. Just give you an opportunity, and for anyone else that might want to submit one, I think what we'll do is, for time's sake, since we're 4 minutes to one, I'm going to try to get one.